2021, I made about $1 million. 2022, you know, the market collapsed. It's 3D art. It's on a 2D screen. And I feel like I'm starting to get tired of people watching my art on a 2D screen. I've never been the best friends with the algorithm. I've never been like the kind of person to go for that viral fame on Instagram. Yeah, I literally left the job with a laughing face and a peace emoji.
In today's amazing episode, we're joined by David Aryu, a digital sensation who's redefining the 3D and VR world. Known for his collaborations with global icons and innovations in the NFT space, David's art is truly groundbreaking. Before we start the podcast, we're going to be showing a video he made that shares his artistic journey. If you don't know David already, this will give you an amazing glimpse into who he is and the unbelievable artwork that he has made. So without further ado, get ready to have your minds blown and be very, very inspired.
Hey, great to meet you. My name's David Aryev, and I'm a 3D artist, digital artist, NFT artist, whatever you'd like to call me. I've done work for artists like Katy Perry, Keith Urban, Zedd, Deadmau5, Excision, The Lumineers, and Drake. I created two of the Beeple and Madonna NFTs, as well as exhibiting my work at Beeple's grand opening. I was an artist on POC's Ash 2 drop, and I sold a piece of work in the Sotheby's Contemporary Evening Auction for $224,000. But I'll get into all that in more detail later. I've been doing 3D work for 12 years now, and I have several different styles, ranging from cinematic short films, full CG music videos, concert visuals tightly synced to the music, and my personal favorite, abstract pieces of work that come to life through light and reflections. I'd like to quickly run through my history as an artist. Prior to NFTs, I gravitated towards concert visuals and music videos because they were the most artful mediums I'd found for people like myself, pushing the boundaries of what a solo artist can do. I'd find myself taking on hugely ambitious full CG music videos and gradually digging myself out of the impossible tasks I'd taken on. But this process allowed me to grow in leaps and bounds. Often clients would give me full creative control and allow me to do everything myself from concept to execution, which got me comfortable with blank slates and allowed me to pursue my own artistic visions and focus on the soft skills that only came with years of experience, like storytelling, composition, color theory, lighting, and camera movement. I'm also a well-known educator in the 3D community, and I created a course that took me over a year to complete called Lights, Camera, Render, where I downloaded as much info in my brain as possible for up-and-coming 3D artists and the pros alike. I got sucked into NFTs in late 2020 thanks to my buddy Beeple. I've been friends with him for many years, and I used to do the logo animations for his Control Z events, as well as curating the reels of all the best motion design work from that year, which were projected at the parties. I also worked with him on his title sequence for the FITC conference in 2019, as well as concert visuals for Zedd, where he would create the style frames and animation tests, and then I'd take the work to the finish line. So when he dropped his 2020 collection of NFTs, I was right there along for the ride, and I purchased one of his Into the Ether pieces, which I still own to this day. I've sold a ton of other NFT assets, but I'm holding this one forever because I know he's going to continue making waves as an artist and has more determination and hard work ethic than anyone I've ever met. Anyway, fast forward to February 2021, when my schedule freed up and I took the plunge into NFTs. I released 3 short films on Maker's Place, and they were immediately scooped up by the collector 888 for $16,000, $24,000, and $30,000 respectively. Then I showed him the 4th film in this cyberpunk series that I hadn't minted yet, and he was so impressed with the piece that he agreed to a price of $65,000. At this point, I was all in on NFTs and the promise of digital artists making a living in this space, as well as collaborating with their peers and creating a movement of unique digital art supported by their collectors. I managed to stay in Web3 full-time for over 2 years, and I'm still in it part-time in spite of the bear market because I believe in the technology and the amazing communities of artists and their fan bases, and I love the innovation that continually emerges from the space. Here's a few more highlights from my NFT roller coaster ride so far. I created this trailer for 888 The New World, a platform that sadly never came to fruition, but the trailer made a massive splash in the space. And I led a team of 7 artists to create this trailer in less than a month, and my insanely talented wife, Chelsea Evenstar, was one of the artists on the team. She designed the Angel character. In October 2021, I sold this piece titled Immortalis for 40 ETH, which is my highest solo sale to date, and at the time that was just over $140,000. I was one of the few artists selected by Pac himself to be part of his Ash 2 drop, and I created a piece inspired by his black and white geometric aesthetic. It was an honor to be in his shortlist of the most talented artists in the Web3 space. I also created two of the Beeple and Madonna NFTs from scratch, with Beeple directing. Needless to say, this is probably the weirdest job I've ever done in my career, but it was still a lot of fun. Mother of Evolution sold for $146,000, and Mother of Nature sold for $346,000. In April 2022, I released a collab piece with the famous Chinese artist Jia Ai Li that began with his incredible painting, which I brought to life as a full 3D animation. It was sold in the Sotheby's Contemporary Evening Auction alongside legendary artists such as Banksy, Basquiat, Damien Hirst, and Jeff Koons for $224,000. This was such a huge success and honor, and a career highlight for sure. Then, more recently in February of this year, I did an open edition that sold 715 pieces for 0.033 ETH each, netting around $40,000 total. And then I supported that collection with a series of burns that cut the supply in half over time. There are now 7 pieces in the collection, and there are more planned on the horizon. After that, I created a piece for World of Women that brought Chelsea's angel character into my infinite mirror realm for the first time, and I'm extremely proud of how this turned out, both in the visual experience as well as the audio that perfectly fits the piece, designed by my sound wizard, Abel Okugawa, who creates the music and sound design for all of my NFTs. Also exhibited my work at Beeple's grand opening in March of this year in Charleston, South Carolina, creating a piece for the massive high-res projection surfaces that took over the space and immersed viewers in a peaceful journey through my abstract realms. And on that note, I'd like to dive into the abstract work that I'm so passionate about, and that I'm bringing to Digital Art Fair Asia in just a few days in the form of a 9-minute meditation immersion room experience, a 2.5-minute VR experience, 3 limited edition pieces, an open edition, and finally an 11-minute meditation one of one. I've recently adopted VR as my new favorite medium, and I've created a full 2.5-minute experience that's hard to describe because you just have to try it to understand. It puts you into a trance-like state where you're floating through these infinite hallways of light, above and below, and literally bringing the work from 2D to 3D, where you can perceive depth. It's a very personal experience that's unlike anything I've ever seen before, and I believe it will leave a huge impact on people who attend the conference. If not for NFTs, I never would have gone down this rabbit hole of creating infinite mirror rooms in 3D, and then adding more and more techniques to this style until it really became what I'm best known for artistically. These pieces began as more concrete rooms where you could understand the geometry of the space, but over time they evolved further into long-form psychedelic experiences bordering on fractal art. The symmetry and constant movement of the pieces creates a hypnotic sensation of transcending the body and entering a heavenly realm, drifting through angelic cathedrals and clearing the heaviness of day-to-day life by leaving consciousness outside the experience and allowing the viewer to be fully present. They create a sense of calm, awe, and the knowledge that there's always more to this universe than we realize. For me, this art is also representative of my spiritual awakening. I was raised as an atheist, but my art brought me to a place where I could overcome that lack of belief in anything, where I could understand that we are all creators for the time that we're here, and that using our hearts as a guide will lead to a life full of positive energy and abundance, and anything else is blocking that. What exists out there is incredible, and it's incredible that we're discovering the universe and inventing the universe every day. My goal in life is just to touch the people who visit my experiences and see my art and fill them with positive energy. I hope to see some of you soon at the Digital Art Fair.
So you know you've worked with Madonna, Drake, Carrie Payne.
I love Carrie Payne.
Well, now that's her name now that she's on American Idol and sounds like a Southern belle. So
that's so funny.
Yeah, so I'm gonna start over.
With yeah, that, just right? From the top.
No. Don't start over. Don't start, keep going. That's the best ever.
So, all right. So Carrie Payne, you know, icon. And with several other artists that are just massive. What's it like working with them, and how did you even go about getting them as a kind of a connection?
Well, a lot of it is through bigger companies. Like I just did, for instance, I just did this opening ceremony for this Saudi Arabia festival called Riyadh, which is like this opening to this huge boxing match. And that was through this company Possible, and they're super chill to work with, you know? So it depends. Katy Perry was through another company called Silent Partners Studio. But I do have some direct connections. So DeadMau5 was one example of where I went actually to his house in Toronto and worked with him for a few days, and then later came back for a whole week at his house in Toronto, which was absolutely crazy. And that connection was through the MoGraph guys, Matt and Dave. They
love them.
It happened to be that he was watching like all the, he was streaming like every night, and he uses Octane, right? He uses, he's such a dabbler, right? And he was kind of creating his own concert visuals. He had recently, I think, gotten burned by a company that was trying to charge him like a couple hundred grand. And turns out they were just like tweaking Beeple clips, Beeple project files. And so it's like he had a bad taste in his mouth working with people. So he was like just kind of streaming every night, doing his own thing, creating his own concert visuals. But he was watching a lot of tutorials. And so he stumbled on some, and at the time, I think they were BroGraph. He stumbled on some BroGraph tutorials, and then he actually like sent them a message, and they were like, holy shit. And he was like, do you want to, you know, work together in some way? Or I think they may have like responded to him first saying like, hey, you were watching our stream. And so it kind of just happened organically that way. And they were like, oh, we've got this other guy, David, check out this, the type of visuals he does. And he was like, holy shit, this is really good. He was like, do you guys want to, you know, come and work with me at my place? And we were just like, fuck yes. So we kind of like filmed the whole thing. And yeah, it was amazing. Like he is also edgy. He can be a total dick. Like that that guy is just insane. I mean, he's like, you can kind of tell with how, you know, sometimes aggressive with his fans he is, and how he has to apologize. He's got an attitude.
I took a masterclass from him.
You took a masterclass?
I took his production masterclass.
I watched most of it.
Yeah. And it was even just via a masterclass, there are moments where you're like, all right, but it's also like he's just so singularly, he's got such a singular vision for his music and his art, and so like I totally get to your point. There's like he's got lines that he definitely draws, and you know the first time you encounter it might feel like a little whoa, but
yeah,
you know you got to respect it for the art it ends up producing. Totally. I think.
No, and I don't regret the experiences at all. Like, you know, I mean, we were grinding pretty hard, like 14, 15 hours a day. Like
it was
imprisoned by DeadMau5, basically. He's like, you guys are going to bed. He's kind of like, yeah, it's 4 a.m. We're going to bed. Your wife already came down and said goodnight to you. Like, we're going to bed. but, you know, there were some awkwardnesses and whatnot, but it was so fun. I mean, celebrities, they're just people, you know, they're like, he's like anybody. He's just a tech nerd, and you know, totally goofed around with him. We went on like an ATV adventure, and I nearly killed myself. It was out in the snow, like through his back paths, and you know, I almost flipped it over backwards on a log. But, you know, good times.
This is kind of a bit of an aside, but did you ever work with Nick Smearballs?
Tons. Nick's a good friend of mine. Nick made the Octane Jesus. He photoshopped my face into Jesus.
What the fuck, dude? That's such a
joke. That is amazing.
I mean, such a small world. Like,
small world. Very, very small world.
Well, yeah. But I mean, sorry, not to like try to, this might feel like a reach, but I feel like this is exactly what you're talking about like, I mean, look at that. Like you work with one person who knows somebody else, you know, especially in motion design or like 3D, especially with tech progressing to the point where 3D can be as accessible to so many people.
100%.
At the end of the day, like right now is the smallest this industry is going to be
The
rest of forever. You know?
Right.
Like,
it's a good thing to remember too.
You know,
yeah.
Get out there now, and like, you'll be surprised at just like the number of people that you end up crossing paths with that know someone else, or, you know, those projects, the staff always seems to like shrink down to like, you're like, I know everyone. Like,
yeah, no, I mean, it's a beautiful time to be in this industry because it is constantly expanding, like you're saying. And I mean, like, I think that's why we have always had this attitude of free information sharing, like from Nick Campbell and Andrew Kramer and whatnot. Like, they definitely set that whole thing up. But everyone else has like carried the torch. You know, I'm always talking to people who are creating new and innovative tutorials that I'm learning from. And it's incredible. And I think that attitude, there's not a whole lot of other industries that have that attitude. Like, I've seen inside the photography world and some of these other, and like the film world, and they're much more cutthroat, much more competitive, hold your trade secrets closely. And like, for us, it's like, no, there's more than enough work to go around because there's so many different applications of motion design, whether even, you know, 2D and 3D art. And now we're going to just get even further into the world of VR and these massive experiential things and all of it. You know,
it's crazy to think how deep the rabbit hole was pre-VR, AR, you know, I mean, in many ways, even AI and like mm-hmm. machine learning and all these ways to create. The rabbit hole for like 2D and 3D was already so deep. So exactly to your point, it's like, that was the beauty of it, is you can share your trade secrets because tomorrow you're probably going to find like 15 more on the project. You know, like there's a million ways that, you know, one thing that I found really useful too, like Will Clark, who's been on the podcast, goes by Meatball. He and I did a thing the other day where like I had posted something. He was like, I want to take a stab at that. And then we got on a call and we both pulled up our project files and we're like, here's how I did it. And he's like, here's how I did it. And they both kind of had the same result, but it was like totally different approaches. And it was such a kind of a fun exercise. And like, that is the creative aspect of what we do. You know, it's not that every person is going to approach it differently and that you shouldn't feel intimidated by seeing someone else do something that you don't know how to do, you know?
Yeah, exactly. And like, I feel like every time I've given away my trade secrets, quote unquote, it's only ever come back to me tenfold. Like, every time I create a tutorial or a course, it spawns more work. It spawns like clients coming to me to ask me to do that thing. Or, and also like, if you're a great artist that's constantly learning, constantly evolving, you shouldn't be threatened by people knowing how to do what you do, because you're always going to be several steps ahead. You're always going to have all of those soft skills, that deep information that only comes through decades of experience or however many years you've been doing this. And like, that stuff you can't just absorb in a tutorial. So I'm never like, you know, I want my tutorials to be like Legos, where I create the base for you and then you build up off of it. You know, like with the digital nature stuff, it's like, here's a pretty looking nature scene, now make it your own and apply it to your own stuff. You know, yeah.
100%.
And that's the other thing I was gonna say. And, you know, along the line of it always coming back to me tenfold, like, if I hadn't been such a well-known educator in the 3D world, like, I wouldn't have been successful at NFTs. So when NFTs landed, everyone, like all the other artists, were like, this dude's legit. You know, they were all retweeting me like, this is the guy that taught me how to do the thing. Like, you know, this guy's important and like his work is valuable. So like, thanks to that, you know, I'm successful at NFTs.
So. Yeah. So your initial generosity, with just, and passion, you know, to share knowledge. Yeah. It's like, at the time you're making those decisions for yourself and your career without really any expectation of what could come back. And like, obviously, you know, it's one of those things where I think it's like definitely a karmic, you know, you put out good vibes.
It is karma. Yeah, there is karma. Pretty much comes back. Sure. Yeah.
Well, in terms of your career and getting jobs through helping people, what's been kind of your favorite client to work with?
Well, Zed is really, really awesome, because that's another one like Deadmau5 where the connection is pretty close. It's only one step removed. So Zed's VJ, his name is Gabe Damast. He goes by Silly Gabe. He's like an amazing Octane artist as well. Amazing NFT artist. But yeah, he was Zed's VJ for like 9 or 10 years, though at some point they started switching the visuals over to a time code locked set. So there's no real VJing. It's kind of like Zed really just pushes a button and hypes everybody up, you know? But, you know, he designs it to be almost like a theater experience, you know, where it's like he's designed this whole massive experience. Like, so why does there have to be this this element of on the fly live randomness when he could create an even better experience by having everything designed beforehand. So that's kind of his philosophy. So the whole VJ thing got a bit phased out, but Gabe's way of pivoting was to learn Octane and get more involved on the 3D side of things. So Gabe, I think maybe he'd seen my tutorials, or he knew me through Beeple, because Beeple was also, you know, working on Zed stuff for years before I was. And I have my own independent, you know, connection to Beeple. But so the three of us kind of got together, and Gabe hired Beeple to do like the really rough style frames and really quick animation tests, because he was only in the job for like a week or two, just like, because he's such an idea factory, right? He's just like, here's an idea, you know, doing a bunch of tests. And then I would take all of those to completion and polish the shit out of them and add all of the, you know, timing with the music. And also there were, I'd say a good third of the work was also just straight from my brain. They started to trust me. And, you know, that the best kind of clients are the ones that just trust you with full creative control, and who are like, you know, I want the David Ariev style. I want you to figure it out. You know, I'm not going to sit here and micromanage you. So those are my favorite jobs. My favorite clients are often indie clients, you know, fewer cooks in the kitchen. I don't like working for big corporations. You know, I literally just fired Meta a couple weeks ago from a job that was starting to drive me crazy. I was like, I could tell it was not going to go down a good road. And I'm like, I have the luxury of choice at this point, which is amazing. So I was like triple booked, and I was like, you know what? No, you guys suck.
I'm going to keep using your headsets, but.
Right. Yeah, exactly. It was through an ad agency that was working for Meta. So you didn't have that. So, but it was a job for Meta. And you know, yeah, I literally left the job with a laughing face and a peace emoji. Because they were like, I was like, do you want to, I was like, well, guys, I'm out of this job after this call. I really didn't feel like we're vibing right, or it's not feeling right to me. And it was at the very beginning of job, so it was not a big deal killing the job. And I was like, but you know, I'd hired two of the best animators in the industry, right? And I was like, but my guys are totally willing to keep working with you if you want. And they were like, we will never now or ever hire you or anyone affiliated with you. And I'm like, okay, bye.
Wow. It sounds like you maybe made the right call on that one.
Yeah, I definitely
a little bit. I wanted to ask, like, so I know, you know, mentioning a Beeple a few times, obviously a legendary staple in the industry. So one big project you guys worked on, which I'm still blown away by, I guess it was Beeple and Madonna and you made an art project. What was that like? Can you just kind of describe what that project was?
Oh dude, it was the weirdest fucking project I've ever done in my life. Please don't play it in this podcast. Like, anybody can go look it up. It's, you know, I think the site is, motherofcreation.xyz. And Smearballs was on that project too, by the way. He did.
Okay.
So I did the tree and the butterflies, and Smearballs did the centipede, the techie centipedes. Yeah, that job started with Beeple calling me being like, Madonna's got some nasty fucking shit she wants to do. You want to get in on this, bro? I'm like, sure, buddy. It was bull run madness. And, you know, he was like, I don't know. That it was like very on and off for like a year. Like he would ghost me for a while, and a project would go away because he was busy being famous. And then Madonna would ghost both of us because she's super famous. So it was a bit of a shit show. It was like such a long, drawn out process. Like, it should have taken like 2 months of hard work.
Did you have to ghost them just so that they knew you were famous?
There were actually times when I was like, dude, I'm booked right now. Like, you can't, at one point I remember being like, you can't keep coming back into my life like this, buddy. you're like, I know, bro. I'm sorry.
That's impressive though. A whole year. I didn't realize that was like a year long process. Yeah. But that kind of makes sense considering all of your guys' schedule and that time, you know, that was like
animation
a pinnacle for a lot of you.
To me, the animation's not to my standards of quality. Like, it's good. You know, I like had to go back and revise about a million things with like X particles fucking up, or this or that thing intersecting, or, you know, this woman body looking shitty because it was from Daz, so let's upgrade it to character creator. And then like, oh, this still has Gumby arms, and you know, there's just a lot of that. But it's like, and it was, you know, it's in Beeple's style to some degree, which is a little bit more flat lit, you know, not like super dramatic, like not necessarily the kind of lighting and stuff that I would do. I mean, it's a good mix. It's like a Beeple and I like work well together, and somehow it becomes like a 50-50 kind of feeling where it's like I'm taking his idea and still delivering work that's like within his wheelhouse, within his style. You know, that's a tricky thing collaborating. It's like, how do you collaborate with another artist and have it be where your vision is still coming through and it still feels like your art? So to me, it feels like Beeple's art, Beeple and Madonna's art, and I was like the vehicle for delivery.
Wow. That makes
sense. Yeah.
Yeah. I actually had that question written down, and I was curious on how do you...
Hey guys, real quick, just want to let you guys know about some products we are having in our store. So we wanted to advertise to digital artists. We hope these are a great holiday, birthday, any sort of gifts for either yourself or friends, family, coworkers, you name it. Let us know what you guys think about this, because we really think they're awesome. So I'm gonna cut myself off. Back to the episode.
How is that dynamic working? Because when you're working with other artists, obviously every artist kind of wants to have their vision, and you're working directly with these massive artists. So
yeah,
how do you kind of balance out your style versus their vision?
That's a good question. I mean, oh, and I did mean to say that Madonna, I never talked to her. Never. I don't know. You know, it was all through Beeple. It was, you know, he was literally directing everything and I created everything from scratch. You know, he did send me a project file of like this, city that he built for one of his everydays, and we use that for the base of the butterfly. So he'll do things like that, like just send me little project files once in a while. And I'm actually working on a project with him right now that I can't talk about, but it'll be out in probably a couple months, I'm guessing.
I'm excited.
Yeah. But so the process for me with almost anyone is like, okay, let's take all the input, all the direction, all the ideas, and then try to take everything they said and make it a bit better. You know, just like whatever it is, like make it the best it can be. You know, that's just like, for me, it's more of a standards of quality thing. Like I'm always trying to make it the best it can be, but within reason. Like I'm also balancing time. You know, I can't go down the rabbit hole on some small little detail that's like, yeah, maybe it would be amazing if I, you know, animated the shit out of this for several days or whatever. But, you know, so it's kind of like trying to hit that quality and like good and fast at the same time, you know? You don't want to be good, fast.
What's the triangle? The
good, fast, cheap.
Yeah, good, fast, cheap. You can only pick two.
You can only pick two. So I guess I'm fast and good.
I'm not cheap.
Exactly.
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's great. I'm glad to hear it. Like, I definitely think having your own standards is great. And I kind of wanted to ask, you know, we were talking a little bit about some of your personal projects. How do you, you know, anyone that saw the bio reel, they understand you've kind of made a pretty good portion through the NFT phase.
Right.
So how do you, you know, I feel like if I asked any of my friends, like, if I gave you a bunch of money, what would you do? The first thing they would say is like, I'm going to go on vacation for a year or two.
Right.
But I would feel say like the same when thing, I looked actually. At no. Well, I feel like what was funny about you is like you had so much success, and instead of kind of seeing like a pause in your artwork, you just raised your own bar and you kept pushing it even further. And I was
there's
just
multiple
like
multiple reasons for that.
What is your, yeah? So what are those?
One of the reasons is that I lost all the money. No joke. Look, so, okay. 2021, I would say I made about $1 million.
Yeah.
2022, wow. You know, the market collapsed. I had a lot of it in, you know, in ETH and NFTs. Like I've got a big NFT collection. Now it's like, you know, a lot of it's not valuable. And I sold like all of 2022, I was working on a project called Diamond Dawn that I thought was going to be the next greatest thing that was going to make me millions of dollars. And it, long story short, it flopped. Right. So I spent a whole year on it, invested my own, my like completely full time, and sold off tons of NFT assets through 2022, and ended up 50 grand in debt. So ever since
wow.
then, I've been slowly recovering. I'm still a little bit in debt, but I'm not, you know, not as far in debt as I was. So that's part of the answer. I mean, but that's the roller coaster ride of NFTs. And also we got to build this basement that I'm in. Like, it's an entire like 1600 square foot, like dope pad. We invested like 350K into it. So like, it's not as if I came out the other side, like, worse off.
By any means, that's a whole house in New York.
That's a whole house. So I'm not, and we have two horses and I've got a pinball machine. So I've like completely expanded my life and the scope of like what I enjoy and my hobbies. Yeah. And thanks. What,
rich dad, poor dad. You're not in debt if you're buying assets. You know what I mean?
Fair enough. Fair enough. Yeah. Yeah. So that's it feels exciting. Like being poor, but exactly what you said. So
yeah.
But no, that still keeps the fire lit under my ass. I'm still grinding. So like recently I was triple booked on a job for, like I mentioned, the Riyadh festival, but I was also doing some visuals for the Sphere, which will come out soon for Coca-Cola.
No way.
Yeah.
What? You're working on the Sphere?
I already did, yeah.
How did I miss that?
Well, because I haven't announced it yet. I haven't posted it yet. And I don't know if I'm breaking into, well, I didn't say what the, you know, what.
No, you didn't say nothing.
Well, look, I mean, you were posting some like what ifs.
Right. I did. And that's how I got the template. That's how I got the template was I ran my VR experience through the Sphere template.
Because
I had the template because I was, working for the Sphere. But yeah, like, yeah.
Huge congrats, by the way. That's amazing. Yeah. That's a really, really cool.
It's going to be the
canvas moment in time. That's very cool.
Yeah. And so the way you render stuff for the Sphere is by actually treating it as a VR project. And then whatever internal Sphere you have gets flipped to the outside.
Wow.
Interesting way to work. Yeah.
I'm very excited to see it because I believe
the outside is in, like
and
you're
then, like a VR,
you're imagine as everything inverted and then it.
Yeah, so you put the camera in the center of a big sphere or environment, and then whatever you render is a full 360, and then that gets flipped inside out to the outside of the sphere. Yeah, that makes sense. Because I was working on the outside of the sphere, not the inside.
Got it.
Wow. I do want to go in because I feel like that's almost leading into VR territory, which I want to save that for a little later here. But before we get into that, because I we're still before VR. There was Octane Jesus, so for people that don't know about Octane Jesus, that's how I've, when I first started 4 years ago, I started with Cinema 4D and Octane. So I've been following you for years now.
Yeah.
And that's how you've always been known in my mind.
That's so cool.
And what other people refer to you as. When did you get that name and how did that name even come about?
Yeah, it's kind of like a secret superhero name at this point. At one point I was like having an artist identity crisis and I was like asking Twitter whether or not I should just change my handle to Octane Jesus. And they were like, no, we've come to know you as David Aryev. And hold on, my dog, Kita off. She's harassing the cat.
Oh, that's too funny.
Here, there he is.
Oh.
Dude, if I – so the sound that I make
– that's the gold right there.
My cat off of things. I do like the – to get him up and off shit.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But now my dog is trained that when she hears that noise, she'll like come out of like nowhere and be like, I got to fuck this cat up. And I'm like, no, that's not what we're doing right now. Like, I just need
to – that's obnoxious. Yeah, the way that animals all interact together can be so annoying. Such a
also just like you had a cat chilling back there the whole time.
See, look at this. It's like a war.
Hi.
Anyway, so Octane Jesus, that came about probably around 2018 or so, 2018, I would guess. It was just a random comment that someone left on one of my tutorials. People noticed that I was giving away a lot of information for free, creating maybe higher quality Octane tutorials than had existed before. And that was all thanks to EJ, by the way. EJ encouraged me to create Octane tutorials. EJ's like me, it's like if there's a lack of knowledge in some aspect of software, you just want and you want to learn it. You like go find your friends that are really good at that. And you're like, please make me a tutorial, bro. So that was kind of EJ encouraging me to make tutorials. And thankfully, he let me release them on his channel, which already had a huge viewership. So that kind of like skyrocketed my presence in the industry. But yeah, somebody just was like, this guy's Octane Jesus, just because I had long hair. I mean, I still do, but really long hair. And because I was sharing information, I guess. And that just caught fire. And at first I was like, I didn't know how to react. I was like, should I fight this? Should I shut this down? I'm like, no, if the internet brands you as something like that, you just need to roll with it. And so like the memes started flowing in and yeah, literally Smearballs is the one who, this shoulder.
I still can't believe it. That is so amazing.
Yeah. Yep. So he photoshopped my face in Jesus's picture, and the rest is history. And I've been using it as a PFP for, you know, probably 4 or 5 years now. And yeah, I mean, it's like, at first it started almost as like a joke, like, you know, like people are used to like South Park and all these things, like making fun of religion vaguely and all that. But now it's almost like it's turned around, and it feels like almost like an ideal or a goal or something to, you know, aspire to. It's like, actually, who was Jesus? Oh yeah, he was like a really generous dude. He was like a really awesome guy that, you know, changed the world. And it's like, okay, you know, let's try and build community. Let's try and, you know, teach everyone. And let's try and heal the world with art, you know? And so those are like some new loftier aspirations, thanks to Octane Jesus.
Need to Photoshop a picture of Jesus with the fish, but it'll be like an Octane tutorial. They gave it out to the masses.
Exactly. Buy for our samples.
I love it. Well, so I, you know, getting this story, you've been using Octane for 5 years. Like, I mean, the funny thing is it's not even like a software. Well, I mean, it is, but it's a render engine, right?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
What has you so Octane ride or die versus, you know, Redshift or going into other programs that don't even have Octane? Like, there is Houdini, there is Unreal Engine.
Lots of answers to that question.
I'm excited. And maybe how do you also value it better? What makes you think it's
right? Of course. Well, just on the simple technical end of things, I think it's a really artist-friendly tool. You know, I think it's really easy to connect nodes. Like, I don't love Redshift's nodes. Redshift's displacement map is kind of bullshit. Like, Octane has this magical image-based displacement map that creates tons more detail and doesn't cost hardly any VRAM. That's a huge one for me. You know, they're adding in lots of experimental features like OSL nodes that let you do all sorts of weird, crazy, wacky things. And people are always discovering new ways to tweak out Octane with all of the experimental stuff they have in there. It feels like they're really rapidly developing the plugin. It has much faster navigation speed in general with than Redshift. Like, the IPR updates really, really fast. They're building things like lens flares and chromatic aberration. They've got a really amazing caustics engine that they've just put in there. And then there's things like fisheye lenses and all these interesting bokeh and crazy camera stuff you can do, post-processing, bloom, that's really, really accessible. I mean, obviously Redshift is trying to copycat some of those things, but I think Octane does it better. Octane, your result will look more like photoreal right off the bat, which is a huge, huge thing for me. You know, it is unbiased to a large degree, though it still takes some shortcuts. It's not like 100% unbiased or whatever. And then I will say, like, obviously Redshift kind of wins in the volumetrics department, you know, to some degree, but I think Octane's coming up really fast with that too. They've just added like a new post-processing volume that looks really amazing, that does a lot of the same things Redshift does, with like the light having the spread and allowing to target like specific lights to just specific volumes, and having, you know, some lights only be volumetric and others, you know, only affect the lighting on characters without affecting the volume, like those kind of inclusions and exclusions. You know, their passes, I'm sorry, I'm just going on a rant, but
no, I love hearing all of it.
Yeah, the passes have gotten really good. You know, I've used Octane recently in a big studio job, you know, at this studio called Modern Logic or Modlo. And we used it on this big spot for Back Market, you know, the whole pipeline with, you know, really professional compositors. And it was able to do everything. You know, the crypto mats worked out great. You know, everything. Yeah, it's really good at compositing now too. You can do the Aces workflow, any of that stuff that you want to do. And like, they have some really artist friendly, interesting features like Vectron. Like, where did Vectron come from? It's a fractal render engine built into Octane. And I've seen people do really amazing things with it. So they're more, to me, they're just more
it's of an the beta though, right? It's still in beta.
Yeah. Yeah, but whatever, it's still like they're trying all these insane things. And honestly, they have a much better community, in my opinion. Like, you know, Redshift, obviously they've got like the whole Maxon community, which is the best. Like, Maxon really has spurred the community forward more than any other company that I know of, you know, with Paul Babb and Matthias and all of their meetups and, you know, Cineversity and all these things. So they brought Redshift into the fold, but Octane really took a note or took a, you know, page out of Maxon's book. And at first they were not good at community, right? But Matt and Dave and I pretty much like harass them about it. And eventually we got Jules like really listened, and they care a ton about the community now. And so they've got like several roles in their company for community development, and several artists that they hire to make tutorials and to just like be Octane evangelists. And I was one of those for a while, or I like kind of work with them part time now when I'm not like slammed with freelance work, which is never, you know, so I just think they're like, aside from the software, they're a really cool company. And the founder, Jules Urbach, is one of the most future thinking, like smartest dudes. And his heart's in a really good place. Like his goal, his vision is to create the holodeck, you know? And to me, that's the most exciting vision ever. Like that is the canvas that I want to design my art for eventually. Like that's what I like, even more than VR, I want to create for the holodeck. So there you go. That's my Octane spiel.
Hell yeah. I would also like to just say I have integrated the Octane render engine in Blender, and it's incredible. And I've also done Redshift in Blender, and it was much less incredible than the Octane implementation. The only thing with the Octane implementation is that it's locked to a version of Blender. I think it's just because they probably don't have the resources to develop as aggressively for Blender. But I think it's like on we're on 3.6 now. We're about to be on 4.0 in Blender, and I think it's locked to maybe 3.3 right now. But like everything you just said, all of that translates. I mean, I don't use Cinema, so I don't know exactly the workflow there, but like everything you just said translates 100% to the Blender stuff as well, which is just even more reason, you know, the second that I found out you could do Octane in Blender, I had like this sigh of relief being like, wait, this is great, because if I start, you know, collabing more with people who are doing Octane in Cinema 4D, like maybe there's more throughput there, you know, that makes it easier to collaborate. And, you know, that, you know, not to mention, I love Maxon as well, but the Redshift license is not something I'm going to pay for, at its current, you know, in its current form, just because I'm not going to use it that much. So it's also sort of like, it becomes easier to experiment when you have tools like, you know, a Blender plugin that you can use Octane for, you know.
And this might be mind blowing to some people, but if I'm correct, Octane is currently free in Blender.
Yep.
That's what I'm saying. That's what
and it's free in Unreal Engine, and I'm not gonna lie, it looks phenomenal in Unreal Engine. Like, if you feel like Unreal Engine feels like a video game, just put Octane. Yeah. It's a single click, and you're like, oh,
totally.
I mean,
you will have to retext everything, but
you use base materials, you know,
until someone comes up with like the blueprint or the whatever that just like,
oh my god, a one click material transfer in Unreal.
Yeah, that'll be nice. And Otoy is developing Brigade, which is the kind of like UE, it's, you know, and they have been forever. But you know, when it finally does come out, it'll be the real time render engine, you know, Octane like.
It's going to come out right next to Andrew Kramer's Nebula, right?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. But, you know, it's like at least they're taking the time to develop it properly. Like, I think Redshift released their Redshift RT thing, and it didn't go so hot. You know, it was underdeveloped. I don't really know that much about it, but from what I've heard, that was not that great of a success. And so, like, yeah, you need to take the time to develop these things properly. But when it does come out, of course, that's kind of like why I haven't been like, you know, jumping into Unreal Engine yet so much. It's just like, A, I don't have that much time to learn a whole new language, basically. It's like akin to that, jumping into a new 3D package. But, you know, I'm hoping that Octane will have a solution that'll be really great for real-time render engine, kind of like Eevee is to, you know, Cycles, where you do a lot of the super fast feedback, lighting, and all the things you'll need to do in Eevee, and then for the final render, switch to Cycles for the extra refraction.
And what's excellent about that is like there are very few things they've gotten now to the point where it's very few. Like you were talking about having to like retexture, right? If you go to Unreal and you try to do some Octane stuff in Unreal, right? And you're switching from base materials to whatever. The great part about having like, and obviously biased towards Blender, but like just being comfortable with Cycles and then picking up Eevee when it came out, it's so easy to be like, all right, now, even when you build your materials, you can have the two separate outs for two separate engines and it will toggle between the, you know, so as you're setting a project up, it's just like, you don't feel guilty about, you know, I don't have to feel, not guilty, but I don't have to worry about like retroactively having to undo a bunch of this work.
Exactly.
Which is really nice as well. So
100%.
Yeah, and it's also, I think, you know, I don't think all these conversations aren't happening in a vacuum. I mean, I think that it's really good right now that, like, one, the tech has gotten so accessible. I think mm-hmm. the GPU thing in 2020 or whatever it was an interesting kind of hiccup, but, like, for the most part, people have access to, like, pretty decent GPUs now mm-hmm. at pretty affordable costs. And I think that because now you have more competition, it is just getting better. Like, I think we went through that weird, awkward phase of what do we want? Like, what, you know, at the first, it's just like, we need stuff to be rendering faster and faster feedback as we're designing. Mm-hmm. And, you know, fast forward to today, it's like kind of cool to see all of these companies developing different tool sets and kind of keeping neck and neck. And, like, I think we're getting better tools because of it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Have you tried Octane AI Lights yet?
Briefly. I mean, I know that it, like, I've seen demos where it does speed things up a bit. It's not like some crazy AI solution. It's more like to just clean up some of the noise a bit more quickly.
Sometimes on really quick Instagram things, I'll just use, you know, the normal pass on it without doing the I'm blanking on the name. What's the direct lighting? What is it called?
Direct lighting versus versus path tracing.
Yeah, and direct lighting, but it never, you know, it obviously doesn't look as good, but I just tried a project last week and I clicked AI light.
Yeah.
I was shocked. It actually was, I mean, again, you don't really want to be posting anything with, you know, you want to do path tracing, but
if it looks good, it's good. You know,
if you have a quick little thing and you just want to put an Instagram post and you don't want to spend all night rendering, it's a great little side option. I was kind of shocked. It did the path tracing lighting. I mean, it wasn't mm-hmm. maybe super accurate, but I almost couldn't tell. But
direct lighting can get you really far away. Like that music video I was talking about, the space one, it's called Walk Away, the one that was like a 4-minute music video that took me 4 months.
Mm.
That whole thing has beautiful lighting. Guess what? It's all direct lighting, no path tracing.
Wow.
That was before, that was when I had like 2 980s or something at the most or whatever.
Yeah.
You know? Couldn't afford path tracing. Path tracing was for rich people.
Right. Well, I think speaking of, you know, I like kind of going into this future rich, you know, doing some amazing experiences.
Yeah.
I want to ask first before we go into VR, because you've made a very insane experience. Can you just tell us, because I know that was a heavy render.
Yes.
Can you just tell us what kind of machinery you're currently working on? What's your setup look like?
Yeah, I've got, I can kind of scoot out of the way here. You can see there's a couple of them. One of them I think was crashed. It was rendering a VR scene, but actually that's good because now we won't have the fan noise. So, I've got 4 machines right now. Each is running 2 3090s. So wow. I've got
839.
Yeah. And I've had that for like a year and a half, 2 years now. I want it to be 840 90s, you know, because that would be an easy swap. It's just the money. I think 4 is about where it's like any more than that. And you've got like just wires sticking out of the wall. You already have to upgrade your power. So all of each of them is on a dedicated 20 amp circuit. So you got to get an electrician out. Yeah, because if you run 2 of those on 1 15 amp circuit, you can, you know, trip the breaker or whatever.
Wow. Yeah.
So, you know,
what's the PSU for all for each of those?
Some of them I still have a 1300 watt because it works. But I think it's kind of like those are maybe the more unstable machines.
Yeah,
I think it's better to go for a 1600 watt because
it's kind of crazy, man. But like that is a thing that I just learned in the last mm-hmm. year, where I started having all these really weird little instability things going on. Mm-hmm. And I have a 1000i at HX 1000i from Corsair mm-hmm. that I bought a few years ago, and like. Honestly, I had to like de-throttle a bunch of stuff. I mean, I was overclocking some things too. So
I never go that deep in like overclocking or anything like that.
Yeah. No, I mean even like GPU or RAM overclocking. Like I had to turn off like XMP and like.
No, I don't do any of that.
Way more stable, but like holy shit, it's just crazy that we're at this point where like 1,000 watts, you know, 5 years ago was overkill in pretty much every scenario.
Yeah.
If you're not building like a server farm or render farm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we're still in that like somewhat awkward phase where like yes, render tokens exist, but it's still prohibitively expensive to render on a job, in my opinion, with tokens. Like that VR experience, like Otoy gave me like 15,000 render tokens, right? Because they're amazing. Wow. So that's equivalent to like, well,
I was going
to
say
15 all my grand, but yeah. Then it, like, I had the tokens and then it blew, like the token blew up, and then it was probably worth like 30,000 at least for a hot second. But I wasn't, it's not like I was ever going to sell them or even could, because they were just locked to my account in Render. It was like a different type of token or something. Yeah. But I burned through all of them for that VR experience. I basically, well, I, the first time I rendered it mostly locally, but I was doing it wrong. I was doing the side by side VR, and the issue, and I needed to have top bottom VR. Because top bottom distributes the resolution more equally throughout the sphere
than
side by side.
So not to cut you off, but before we dive into the technical aspects of the VR experience, can you just tell us a bit about your VR experience what it is and what kind of, you know, really just what it is now? And then
I kind of need to jump back to the start of NFTs, because NFTs really allowed me to go from being being someone that does a lot of really cool client work to becoming an artist, like what that actually means. So NFTs were really, really enabled me to do that. And also the pace and the insanity of the bull run in early 2021, I couldn't sit there and like make an epic film for 4 months. I would have missed the whole trend, right? I would have missed everything. So I had to figure out a way to work really fast. And so I started experimenting with these infinite mirror rooms, these abstract pieces, because I could kind of combine them with my concert visual style. And through client work, actually, it was through a job on the Latin Grammys, where they asked me to develop a 3D infinite mirror room, right? And I was like, oh, I don't know if this is even possible. Let's try. Yeah, so this was back in like 2019, I think. And it was for Possible. And it was just style frames, and they wanted me to put a chandelier in there. So I just did like 8 or 10 style frames and put a chandelier in there, and discovered that, oh yeah, it actually does work. You get these infinite reflections. It looks really cool. And then I discovered that if you put bevels on the geometry, you actually see the bevels, and that makes it feel more like a physical space. And you catch like little nice glints of light, and it looks like a more advanced, beautiful look. So that was my first job with the mirror rooms. And I was like, you know what, let's create, I was obviously at the time, you know, doing a lot of tutorials. So I was like, let's make a tutorial about this. And so I did that for School of Motion, and that was really well received. And like along the lines of what I said before, like one opportunity leading to the next, leading to the next, this guy from the Republic of Georgia sends me an email, and I'm just like, is this real? This guy's name is Dmitry Gagochidze. And I'm like, what?
He's like, you need to send me your bank account.
Exactly. I'm like, is this a scam or is this real? But he was saying that he'd found me through my tutorial on infinite mirror rooms, and that he had a real infinite mirror room installation he was doing in Hong Kong, and that he did pre-visualization for it. So I was like, okay, this sounds legit. And so basically I made it only was like less than a month long job, but you know, everything was great. And I made several more infinite mirror rooms with just like characters standing in there, basically to previs out, you know, the actual builds he was going to do. And so that was fun. And then beyond that, someone from Keith Urban's team actually contacted me through the tutorial, you know, saying like, oh, I think this look could be great for Keith's show if you change it up. And so I like made a much more psychedelic version with like more of a laser EDM vibe, even though it was for Keith Urban, it worked. And like timing it to the beat, and, you know, infusing it with even more of my, you know, hyper timing to the music, concert visuals type stuff. So it was kind of like this like relationship that I started developing with the infinite mirror room process. And like on that job, you know, normally I'll get through like maybe 5 or 10 style frames in a day kind of thing. Right. On that job on day one, I was able to pump out like 100 style frames.
Wow.
So I was like, holy shit, this process is fruitful. All I have to do is change the geometry a little bit, you know, change what the emitters that are bouncing light around in the room, change some parameters a little bit, and I get something completely different and unexpected. And to me, that's like so exciting as a 3D artist, because so much of 3D art is like planning out the composition, doing the camera movement, doing the lighting, doing the this. And it's like, you have to meticulously plan it out beforehand. But this process felt so much more freeing and experimental to me, you know, and I could like put a finger on why I enjoyed it, but I was like, wow, this is really fun. And so I kept coming back to it. And then when NFTs hit, you know, I used all of my old work, like those big epic cinematic short films, as runway. I was like, let's sell this, you know. And I would contact my old clients, like the indie client I was talking about who, you know, commissioned the space music video. I was like, you guys want to go halvesies? You want to do a three-way split on this one? And so, yeah, they were all down with that. Like this guy, Ivan Torrent, who I did a project for, was the Space Whales. That was another one of my favorite clients, by the way, because he was so good at like providing not just feedback, but like giving ideas that actually improve the artwork, which is really rare from your clients. You know, usually you have all of the really good creative input, but he like pushed me further to create really awesome things in just 3 weeks. And that job was only $6,000. And then we turned around in the heat of the bull market and sold it for $150,000. And I split it 50-50 with him. So he got a huge paycheck out of that.
Yeah.
This really great musician and awesome guy. But yeah, so where was I going with all that? Like, you know, NFTs really enabled me to, you know, like I was using my old work as runway, but then any of the new drops, I was going for these infinite mirror rooms and creating psychedelic visuals. And I would make these really fun experiences and things, and then watch them smoke a bunch of weed and watch them back and be like, whoa, I made this, holy shit. Because it's like, I'm always, as an artist, looking for complexity for cheap, right? I'm looking for all the shortcuts, you know, that will get me something really beautiful and complex without having to do a ton of work. And to me, this was it. I did things like just stretching out the room on the y-axis, and you create all these crazy reflections like a kaleidoscope. And it's like, wow, this is one of the most complex things as an artist I've ever stumbled onto. So I kept going down that rabbit hole for all of these drops and all of this NFT stuff. And through that, I kind of developed my own personal style. And I'd say within the last 6 to 8 months, I've really evolved even more so, in that I was working with this guy, Jeff, who during the pandemic, he was doing these guided visual meditations because everyone was stuck at home. So he was kind of like this super spiritual, extremely nice and chill dude from Ireland. And he was like, you know, commissioning visuals that were kind of hypnotic that people would watch. And like when you're meditating, you want like some kind of anchor point, right? You want either the breeze on your skin or your own breath, or the sound of birds and the leaves rustling, like that kind of thing. But another option is a visual. And with visuals, you want something that's kind of like, you know, in the center of the screen, where you can kind of you kind of like get mesmerized by everything out here, but you fixate your perspective onto that. And so my visuals were kind of perfect for that. And he found me through Nifty Gateway. He was like collecting pieces. He happened to be not just this like meditative guru guy, but also somehow involved in Web3. That's a crazy intersection, you know, right there. But he was just like, man, I'm just like your biggest fan. And we would have these calls, and he was encouraging me to slow down my visuals even more, like slow them down, like that, make them really meditative. Like he was kind of finding use for the visuals to where they could heal people and calm people down. So I did that, and I made an 11-minute meditation. This was probably 6 or 7 months ago, an 11-minute visual meditation. That's the longest piece of work I've ever made. And yeah, I love it. I mean, I can sit there and zone out to it for 11 minutes, I guess.
That's amazing. Yeah.
But you know, it's like, it kind of forces you to put your consciousness aside. It like, you're just like kind of locked into place, like staring at all of this complexity and all this stuff. And it kind of pushes all of the bullshit away. So that's where I was getting to with the 2D. I'm going to call them 2D, even though it's 3D art. It's on a 2D screen. And I feel like I'm starting to get tired of people watching my art on a 2D screen. I've never been the best friends with the algorithm. I've never been like the kind of person to go for that viral fame on Instagram, because I don't really care. I want to do my own thing. You know, it's like, I feel like people watch my stuff. They're like, that's really cool. And then they scroll away. They think it's some kind of cool mirror effect or whatever. Right. They don't understand really what it is. So through NFTs again, let me jump back to February of this year.
Sure.
Suddenly the artists were back in the spotlight. Right. So NFT art is kind of a bubble that exists within the larger realm of NFTs and PFPs and all of the craze and madness. Like, yes, Beeple helped kick off the whole trend, right? But, and there were moments where the artist came back into the spotlight, But on the whole, the focus was PFPs. And, you know, nothing wrong with that. I had tons of fun with PFPs, right?
What are PFPs? I'm so
profile
sorry.
Profile pictures.
Oh, yeah.
48s, yeah, okay. You know, all that. Like, all right. The shit that was really, really spurring the trend and blowing up even bigger. And those were kind of more like, the structure of those were more like modern decentralized companies rather than art and artists and individuals. So, you know, it's like we kind of lived in this bubble within, like, yeah, we profited off the trend, but not a whole lot of artists really made it big. And all of us, to some degree, have had to go back to client work, right? It was kind of this insane bubble of hype. But shit, where was I going with this?
February artists are back in the spotlight a little bit.
Oh yeah, that's right. In February of this year, my friend Ness Graphics, you know, he released an open edition, and open editions have been done a million times before. That's just for people that don't know. That's where you release a piece of art and there's a certain window where you can collect it. So it's like, we don't know how big the edition size is going to be, but you can only get it within this window. It could be a minute. It could be 3 days. It could be however long you want to leave it open. We don't know what the final edition is. So it's more along the lines of releasing a series of prints in a specific time of, in a specific
not,
window
and,
where
and like you're not minting them ahead of time and you know,
right. People are minting, people are basically clicking the mint button, right? And there's no cap on how many there could be
can be minted.
So, you know, in the early days in the bull run, like Nifty Gateway was doing all these open editions, and I had friends of mine like Josh Pierce make 600 grand or more in a single, like in an hour, just through an open edition, you know. The open editions were just flying off the shelves. Now that was way too much supply and everything collapsed and all that, but yeah, so that was the model, but it came back around because the PFP Bored Ape crowd had not yet discovered the art sector. So this was kind of the moment where the PFP crowd discovered the art crowd as like, oh, we can invest. We don't have to invest in these monkey JPEGs all the time. We can invest in really cool art. And it's the same model as to what we're used to. And the other tool that really helped spur this along was something called Manifold, which gave the creators control to do their own burns. So a burn is when you take, you know, say you, you're like, if you have five of these pieces, like when you've got too much supply, say somebody bought like five of the open edition, you could burn all five of these, sacrifice them all, and receive a more rare piece instead, right? So it's like a way to reduce the supply and get something higher level. It's kind of like it's gamifying the art.
Yeah.
So Ness hopped on this trend. He hopped on this trend, and even though it was the bear market, he made $2 million in like that. You know, and then he did a series of burns. And so he kind of led that trend. So when something like that happens in the NFT world, at that point, us artists had realized, oh, this is the time where you have to pile on the bandwagon. So that same week I released my open edition, and I sold 715 pieces and I made 40 grand. And then I supported that with a series of burns, which ended up in to be seven pieces in the collection total. And I've got more planned, but that was the moment where I kind of created my own community. Before then I was like more like reaching out on Twitter, like having relationships with collectors through DMs and all that, you know, in a ton of groups, but I'd never gone to the effort of creating my own community. But then this time it was more about me, my art, and my collectors. So thanks to this open edition, I created a Discord. And I was going to say, yeah, with the gamification in my case, I decided to make it to where, like, I did kind of a unique thing where I started with a 15-second piece. And if you burn two of those, you would get a 30-second piece that was longer and more epic. If you burn two 30-second pieces, you would get a minute long piece, like a whole
experience
animation. And then if you burn two of those, there was actually a branching path where I had collabed with this traditional artist, Nate Main, where one of them, he painted the Mona Lisa in profile as if she'd stepped out of her painting and looking at my art, you know, and kind of pondering this weird new digital art and like this kind of mix of traditional and digital. And so if you burn two of the minute long pieces, you'd receive that. So it was like taking it a level back in abstraction. And then another piece that he did where he painted all of these mythical creatures, a bit more of a cartoony flat style, but really, really beautiful. And they're all like staring into this reflection pool and like kind of mystified and hypnotized by my artwork, which is playing in the pool. People could choose which of those they wanted. Some people got one of each, but it ended up being a pretty equal split. It's always almost like, which one do you prefer? And it was like an equal split between the two pieces. So yeah, really interesting experiment. Like, I think that gamification of your art, like a lot of artists shy away from that and they're like, this is gross. My art isn't a game. It's art. It's, you know, and that's true, but NFTs allow this new kind of technology and like new interesting way to present your art. It's like a new medium. It's like if YouTube is brand new, then you kind of adapt to the medium and you make shorter, more viral clips or whatever the algorithm is doing. So in this case, like I used it to tell a story of evolution of my art. So you start with a small piece that's more like a postcard, more like something simple, and then you stack more and more onto itself to build something that has more and more complexity. So you can kind of craft a narrative through that new medium, if that makes sense.
No, that's very cool.
This reminds me very much of Gavin Shapiro, who we had on.
Oh, I fucking love Gavin.
Gavin's a genius. 100%. And Gavin's Power versus Meaning collection.
Yes, 100%.
Is, you know, when he was describing it to us, it sounds very similar in terms of giving your collectors or people that are purchasing your art, giving them this other, it's just a whole new way to interface. Like, it's, you know, I buy art all the time, I buy physical art all the time, but like, I can't do what we're talking about here. I mean, I'm sure maybe there is a way to do it in the physical world, but it's it just seems like more accessible in the digital realm. And I think it's so, I do agree. It's like, you have to look at it not so much as a copping out, or I don't know, like to your point of, you know, the gut reaction to be like, no, it's my art. It's like, no, this is like, it's the equivalent of like when we went from film cameras to digital cameras, or, you know, it's, you can still do 100%. The same stuff you've been doing. Now you just have a new, and you're also not obligated to use the medium if you don't want to, you know?
Right. I mean,
that's the other thing is like, if it's not for you, it's not for you. But I think it's very cool to see, and especially after, I mean, I really appreciate how kind of like, matter of fact you are about all of the NFT craze, and just honestly being transparent about your success, and, you know, even saying dollar amounts and stuff, because I think for a lot of people there was so much froth and so much money being traded so quickly that the narrative was completely lost. Like, the worst part of it was that blockchain technology, which is not inherently part of, you know, NFTs and blockchain aren't the same thing, but it suddenly, you know, in public, I feel like in public discourse, everything just, all the nuance.
There was a lot of confusion. I mean, like, one article kind of ran rampant and convinced everyone that NFTs are destroying the environment, when in fact, YouTube by itself takes way the fuck more energy than Ethereum.
Every Amazon data center that
AWS. Like, now, and it's like, guys, ETH 2.0 is coming. Oh, it came and went, and now it's way less impact. Right. Like, you know, So all of that was a little bit madness. And then, of course, there was like any kind of bull run or gold rush, people are going to act weird. I had friends that got like really opportunistic and started stepping on other people's toes or faces or whatever to get to a place where they thought they could make more money, and that like their ugly side came out, you know, like money makes people weird. And so it's not surprising that NFTs got a bad rap. But the people that stuck around in the space, you know, after the dust had cleared, after, you know, the bull run was over, are the people who really believe in the technology, think that, and a lot of them are innovators, like inventors, you know, people at the cross sections of like all these different industries that are looking to combine technologies in new and innovative ways. And they're really excited, and they love art, and they just believe in the attitude of decentralization, which at its heart means that the government and corporations don't have the power anymore. The people do. So that's something not a lot of people understand. There's like a backbone to this movement, that's like a grassroots movement where people really believe that we can restructure society in this decentralized way and do better. So to me, that's really interesting. But I think there will be a million new jobs in this industry, you know, and I think that becoming a digital artist is becoming a new form of a career. I'm seeing lots of artists like
so many. Yeah.
You know, Rafik Anadol is a great example. He's in the MoMA now. You know, his piece is permanently installed in the MoMA. His visuals were on the Sphere, you know, and so I'm kind of looking at him and being like, how do I follow his trajectory? Okay, let's do the immersion room thing. You know, let's do these bigger experiences. I want to graduate from my art being just something that people look at and consume and swipe by to something people actually experience.
Yeah, I can't agree more. You know, anytime I put on a VR, AR headset, I almost instantly
understand, especially as the technology gets better, that the art that we're about to be seeing is going to be on another level. Like, it's so crazy. You'll spend days making art that somebody consumes on a screen.
I know. I hate
inches,
that.
Inches yeah. big. And then when you go into VR, especially on the Quest 3, now that it has the pancake lenses and it's so crystal clear, you're like, mm-hmm. oh, I kind of get it now. Like, yeah. this is how big art should be. And it's even funny because you can have Instagram and TikTok now, and you can even see like 720, you can actually see how bad totally. 720 is
totally.
Versus 1080 and to 4K. Right. And you're like,
exactly.
oh man, 4K content is badass. And when it's blown up, it's breathtaking, you
and
know?
4K is not even, I'll let you know, like in a full sphere, I do 4.5K by 4.5K renders, and that's the most that I can push through that device. But it's still fuzzy. It's still shitty to me. I want at least 8K by 8K yeah. render. Yeah.
It's just such a different experience. You know, like even just watching Instagram and TikTok in VR is kind of amazing. Like I instantly was like, oh, the future is going to be like this. And all of our artwork is going to have to be higher quality now.
Totally.
Like it's so nice to see bar set
we
all
can
the
be
way
over
up here.
With. And we can be over with shitty codec compression on every single, you know, I don't need to have 50 render presets for every social platform and deliverable that I'm sending out to because they all decide to like hack it together on the back end anyways. Like,
yeah,
I totally hear the sort of like, yeah, to be able to experience something like that and having experienced VR, AR, especially, and you know, we talked earlier about, you know, Michael and I are in New York. Like one thing that's really cool about living in New York right now is that we do have access to be able to go and experience like pretty much some of the most bleeding edge stuff. I mean, we don't have the sphere here, but, you know, there's, you know, we got to go and tour Zero Space, which is this incredible studio in Brooklyn that's got volumetric capture. That's got like the Mandalorian
real time video volumetric capture.
It's just like
wow.
wild, man. It's wild. And you experience these things and you realize like it's not, if you'd shown it to me 5 years ago, I would have been like, okay, I could see that in 5 years. But it's like now that I'm seeing it here today, I'm thinking like next year is going to be nuts. 2 years is going to be mind blowing. I can't even tell you, like 5 years is going to be, I can't even tell you what it's going to be. All I know is it's going to be like, it's going to be nuts. It's going to be absolutely insane.
100%.
Okay, so sorry, but your VR experience, where were we?
Right. So I was on this long, rambling journey about NFTs and everything. But so, and I stopped around where I made that Discord community, right?
Yeah.
So the Discord community, they're actually the ones, like once I started getting this fan base of people like encouraging me in there, you know, they're the ones that were like, have you ever tried your renders as a 360 render? Or in VR. And I was like, no. And I've been avoiding it because I knew that it was going to take so much longer to render. And like, I was just on this track of like developing for me, like more and more innovative and new techniques. Like every time I went back into this world of this infinite mirror realm, we'll call it the mirror dimension. I would discover some new technique. Like I kept going in there being like, okay, I think I've tapped this technique out. I'm going to have to switch to a different art style. Like, I don't know. I've done so many things in here. Like there's no way I'll make it innovative and new again. And each time I was wrong, like I would find something new, like some new setting that would make the camera crazy, like a panoramic lens or like a, you know, animating the bevels in some way or like, you know, something that would reinvigorate me and inspire a whole new piece. So I did that for about, you know, a little over 2 years. And I developed more than an hour's worth of content that I built, you know, which is a lot for an animator.
That's wild.
But then this was like a jump in terms of the medium. This was a jump in terms of the canvas, right? So they encouraged me to make a, you know, 360 render, and I did that, and I posted it on YouTube, and it looked really cool. And then people had like a really big response to it. They're like, holy shit, this is amazing. And I was like, okay, I guess it's time to try the VR thing. So I just started with a really simple still, and I didn't know the settings in Octane, but there's just a simple stereo tick box, turn it on, and then there's a slider basically for the interocular distance. And I just started with, you know, whatever the default was. And also there's a really easy panoramic camera to render, just renders the full 360 pano. And so I rendered out a still, put it on a timeline premiere, exported it, and brought it into the headset. And at first it was like, ah, this hurts my brain. It's really small. It's like really bad. I'm like, that's not right. I like tweak the interocular distance down, down, down. And eventually I get to a place where I'm like, whoa, this is a really big space. This is really cool. Looking down, you see off into infinity. Looking in any direction, you see off into infinity. I'm like, wow, this is really cool. And so then I started rendering animation tests. And this was around the time that I was actually premiering my work for Beeple's grand opening. And so I created like two motion tests, basically. They were not at the right resolution. They were kind of shitty, but it was enough to get the idea across. And when I was at the grand opening with my art that had been mapped to these massive projection surfaces and LED columns and whatnot, like it was this the most epic display of my art ever. I was also running around with my VR headset, my Meta Quest Pro, and putting it onto collectors' heads. And they would be like, dude, you shouldn't have shown me this because this is so much better than this experience here. So that was really trippy. I was getting like such a response.
Nice. Yeah, that's awesome.
That's great. So I'm excited to, so how, you know, with your room that you made, it's super amazing. I mean, it's almost hard to describe. That's the one crazy thing about VR. It's hard to kind of describe it until you're actually in it. Like no amount of words can properly get people into that mindset of how awesome it is. But, you know, with your experience, so it's the mirror room, which is also just trippy because you're in a reality, like most 3D experiences you have are actually 3D worlds. So the quality that you're looking at is very low resolution due to processing power.
Right.
Your room, when you go in, it's like so high quality and you're just in another dimension in reality in HD.
Yeah, that's how it feels. It feels like I've cracked a hole into another dimension and I just want to continue creating in that realm. Like it's not even creating so much as like revealing this new dimension. It's really weird, you know. And and I've had some really powerful reactions from people. Like when I first got to Hong Kong, we were setting up the fair and there was this guy that was kind of just running around, you know, helping people put text on walls and things. But it was late at night and he was like the only person there. And we were there, me and my wife, Chelsea. We're like, hey man, you know, yeah, what's your name? And it was, I think it was a Harold or Howard. But anyway, you know, he was like, oh, my son's got VR. Sure. I'll try this. I'll step in there for, you know, 30 seconds, a minute. And everybody who said they were just going to go in for like a minute, they always stayed in for like 10 minutes. They wouldn't take it off. And so he goes in there and he comes out with like a completely different look on his face. And he's like, it's like, that was really powerful. I was not expecting that. He took like minutes to recover and he almost looked like he had tears in his eyes. And he was like, he's like, man, you have to be careful with this. This is like the land of the gods. He was like, you need to not let this fall into the wrong hands.
Yeah.
And I was just like, what?
Well, I can quit being an artist now. That was I don't think I'm going to get a better comment than
no
that.
No higher praise, really.
No higher praise. Yeah. And, you know, kids would, like, people would bring their families back, right? The VR was the hit of the show, the entire show. Like, not the immersion room, not the thing I spent 2-3 months developing. I mean, obviously, I spent a long time on the VR experience, probably 2 months. But the immersion room I worked on even harder. And, you know, but that's because it wasn't being displayed properly, honestly. But the VR does, like, it creates more of a feeling because you're like, isolated. It's fully immersive. You know, you've got, like, really good headphones on, so you're hearing the music. It just literally transports you to another world, and you're seeing in depth. And also, it kind of feels like you're a soul floating through these other dimensions because you don't see your hands and body. So that actually adds to the experience, weirdly. It's like a limitation, we think, but in this case, with my meditative stuff, it helps out. And so people will go in there. There was one woman who came out, and I wasn't there for this, but Chelsea, like, got her out of the experience, and she was literally, like, kind of crying. And she was like, I'm sorry. I don't know why I'm reacting like this. I don't understand. Were there voices in there? I heard voices. And Chelsea was like, no, there's no voices. She was like, well, it made me remember things. And then she had to, like, sit down and, like, collect herself for a while. And then other people were just, like, joyful and, like, flying. And I've got pictures of people, like, and, you know, these like serious stoic Chinese people in business suits going like, ah, like so excited. And so, yeah, nothing makes me happier as an artist than seeing like these heartfelt reactions from people. And like, yeah, people would like tell their families and then bring back more and more people the next day. And it was like this major attraction with a queue. Someone was like, I've heard this is the spirit path to death. And I'm like, something like that. I was like, something like that. You'll just have to go in and see. And then they like wrote this whole big Twitter, like, you know, Instagram story or something about how it made them feel like they were transcending their body and that now they're feeling peaceful with death. And it's resolving like any existential crises and anxiety. I'm like, wow. Like, and the other people are like, you could use this at, you know, when people are getting their cancer treatments, or there's so many different uses.
Wow.
That's my art
now.
Yeah.
And so that to me is really mind blowing, that it feels like my art could be used to actually heal people. And that's not something I ever would have thought in the beginning of this journey. It's like, I kind of like, to some degree, art feels selfish. Like it's this frivolous extra thing that we're so privileged to do because we're just having fun and making cool pictures and whatnot. And this isn't really that useful for society because it's just entertainment and, you know, whatever, and it's culture and all that. But, you know, it's not anything that's going to help people survive. It's not building the buildings. It's not doing the hard legwork of society. But maybe that's not true.
Mm.
Yeah. That's incredible. I mean, to be honest, it sounds almost like I went through a very long phase when I was probably like teens going into my early 20s where I astral projected a lot when I slept. Like I would always have really intense, like out of body experiences flying that's around, cool. You know, and I've obviously seen, and from what I gather, it's like you can't really experience the experience you've built until you actually put the headset on.
Right.
But I have seen, you know, I've checked out all of the, you know, the press that you've shared around it, and just like your just generally the experimentation with the infinite mirror rooms and stuff, and that idea of the singular point and everything moving mm-hmm. towards you, and like that is very much sort of like I feel like I've had dreams that are sort of similar to that are kind of moving. You know, it's hard to explain how that kind of like, you know, being in a different space, experiencing movement in a different way, mm-hmm. not physically, not having a body, you know, like you said, not seeing your hands, not seeing your, you know, I can only imagine how powerful that is in a headset. And
yeah,
man, you need to make, you mean now you got to do an update to your bio video, and you need to just have a section of cutting together people's, you know, real time reactions to your work.
Yeah.
That's so awesome.
I mean, I got a bunch of photos, but it's like at the same time it feels weird recording people having these authentic reactions, you know. But it's, you know, I would do this all day every day, like just go around like to different places where it's, you know, an event of some sort and guide people through the VR experience, or just, you know, it's just so fun for me to like, you know, talk to people afterwards. And like at first I was like asking people, so what do you think? And then Chelsea at some point was like, you can't ask what they thought, you have to ask what they felt. I was like, right. And then that would get even more deep responses, you know?
Yeah. So what I'm going to ask $1 million question here, because I'm sure anybody listening with a VR headset is thinking this, but what's kind of your future plan with it? Is this something where you're going to be doing more of like a touring exhibit of it, where you want to be there for the experience to guide people through it? Or is this something where you maybe plan that people can have the David Ari experience at home?
I mean, both, honestly. Like, I already have it up on the Oculus Creator Studio page, where you can literally just click a button and it'll beam to your headset. Now, it's like a lot more compressed than if I sent you the source file. So anyone listening to this, feel free to reach out and I'll send you the source file, and then you can upload it to your headset with a USB-C cable. I like to watch it through this app called Skybox VR, which does a really, really good job of playing it back. But yeah, like you said, it's really a cool opportunity for 3D artists, because we can create these more photorealistic visuals than what the headset can do on the go. Like on the go, it's got N64 graphics, right? And even when tethered, like, yeah, you can have really great video game graphics that look really amazing, but they're still noticeably video game graphics. But I'm creating a pre-rendered, it's just like a video, but it's playing back in 360, in a 360 sphere in stereo. And that lets you do a lot more in terms of the visual fidelity and making it feel like you're really there. So, the future plan for it is to upgrade it, continuously upgrade it. Like when the Vision Pro comes out, I think that'll be able to handle ProRes. So like right now, it still looks like a muddy compressed mess to me.
Right.
Damn, dude, still, that's crazy. ProRes in a headset.
Exactly.
That's going to be so wild.
And 8K, or I think even like Jules was talking about 16K.
Woo!
Like 16K sphere. So
you're going to have to have people sitting because they're going to be tripping over themselves when they put that on, man. 16,
when you say 16K sphere, so do you mean like
I mean the total resolution.
Several stitched together, smaller, lower, like several stitched together, lower resolution panels within that sphere?
Or? I'm not stitching anything. It's like rendering it natively at that. Right now I'm doing 4.5K by 4.5K. If you look at the source file, you'll basically see a doubled image, one on top, right. One on bottom, both of them are full 360 panos and they're slightly offset to create the stereo effect. You know, two cameras that are slightly, separated. When I say 16K, I mean the final resolution of that square video file would be 16K by 16K.
Got it.
Not like 16K per eye. You're seeing maybe 4K per eye or something at best. Right. I don't know how much.
Wow. Yeah,
there's probably some calculation that after you restretch it all back out and actually are experiencing it in headset, but
right.
So I have two more VR questions. But one, so now we have David, VR Jesus here.
Real quick. Sorry to cut you off. I also my other plans for expanding this experience, you're saying the in-person version of that. So that was just all talking about the at home. Like, yes, I want to distribute this to the masses. I want to get it out to the Vision Pro and the Meta Quest and all these different platforms as much as possible and allow people to see it in the best fidelity they can at home. But in person, Maker's Place and I are already talking about what if we had an immersive hallway that led to an immersive room where your headsets are decked out in mirrors and you put on the headset to go further into the art. And it's like this whole insane experience.
Wow.
Holy shit. That's crazy.
Would be so fucking cool.
Yeah. That would be next level.
That would be insane.
Yeah, so I want to go next level for sure.
Well, that was kind of going to lead me into what I was going to say. So, being VR Jesus Christ, what is some of these other future plans that you're maybe either working on or planning? Like, where do you see yourself in the VR space in 3 to 5 years?
I mean, that's just so unpredictable. Sure. It's like, where do I see AI in 3 to 5 years? Fuck if I know.
Fair enough.
I'm trying to get my art onto the sphere. That would be cool. I'm like teasing that. My next plan is to create like a 3D Vegas and then put the sphere in there realistically and be like, this is what my art looks like on the sphere. Like poke, 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 like the same idea of creating the pre-visualization of the immersion room. Like here's what it really would look like. Cause you can show people the template with all the different views, but they don't really have the imagination to put it in the context of Vegas and how like the scale of that thing. So, doing some self promo work on the side to remove that necessity for people to have that level of imagination, if that makes sense.
Yeah. So what I wanted to ask too, lastly, like, where do you see artists? Like, because I think one cool thing about what we're doing with this whole podcast is, and one thing I love, because I love VR so much, and I feel like we've really, one of my hidden goals, if you will, is developing a bridge between 3D artists and VR, because it's just kind of, for some reason, they're the exact same universe, but there's just not a bridge there that people have been walking across. So do you have any advice on maybe something that you would suggest for people to start, or you obviously made that walk across?
Yeah.
What do you kind of see this space might be interesting for them, or I would love to see 3D artists working in XYZ space. And it was a very vague and broad question, but
no, I mean, I would encourage anybody to reach out to me personally. Like I respond to all my DMs. So if you want some info on how I made it work, just hit me up. But literally it's two buttons in Octane. It's the stereo button and the spherical panorama button. And then dial the interocular distance starts out too high. So take it down by a factor of 5 or 10, but it also varies from scene to scene, but just start experimenting. If you've got a headset, output a still. That's the minimum viable product. Just like create a still from one of your cool 3D worlds and see how it feels to be in there. Like it literally can transport you into your own art. So if there's a place that you've designed that you would really want to go, try it out.
That's great advice. I think that's honestly probably the easiest way someone really could take their art and put it into VR, you know, I mean, with just a two button click versus, yeah, just go ahead and learn Unreal Engine real quick.
Exactly. I don't have the time to do that right now. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's awesome. That's great advice. You have actually done work with your wife, Chelsea Evanstar. Is that correct?
Evanstar.
So working with your wife, how is that as a project? Because me and my wife are both artists. We've never collaborated.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Well, she's like a painter. So, okay, gotcha. You know, which I mean, I guess we still could do some collaboration there. But
have her create a painting and then you create a digital part of the painting that where you take an infinite object screen, which is like one of those that plays back a loop or whatever. And then embed that into the painting.
That
there you
we
go.
Gotta talk to you more often. David Aryu is going to be an art consultant for creatives. So how was it working with her? Did you guys get into any hiccups? Was that like kind of an easy, smooth process?
I've always since like we got back together had her look over my shoulder almost annoyingly from her perspective. Like I do it too much. I like distract her. I'm like, hey babe, come look at this, because I always want a second pair of eyes, and she's got a really, really good art sense. She's been around and participating in art for her whole life. Her mom is like a really great oil painter. Her dad's a bird photographer. She's, you know, she ran a dance company for 10 years, so she understands form and bodies. She was in jewelry school. She wrote a young adult novel. She, you know, like the list goes on. She was a, you know, website designer for 10 years, and she also got into 3D NFT art along with the explosion of NFTs. So she's always had a really amazing aesthetic and enhanced the level of quality of my work. I don't think my work would be anywhere near where it is if not for her. So we have been collaborating for years and years and years now. And all the way back to even that client that I mentioned that was the indie client who allowed me to do lots of full CG music videos. There was one in 2018 that I did where he was performing on stage, and interestingly, the whole audience was wearing VR headsets, and I had to do a lot of crowd duplication shit for that. But behind him, there are all of these like kind of wooden feeling cutouts and tons of animation and this almost like stage-like, but also futuristic thing going on. And it was one of my favorite music videos in a weird style that I've only ever done that one time. But Chelsea designed all of the assets in Illustrator. She laid everything out in 2D, and you know, then I would extrude them and light them and texture them and everything and animate them. So we've had like a workflow going for many years, and she would contribute in all sorts of ways for many projects. But NFTs was the first time that it really allowed us to collaborate together to a much bigger degree. And so her whole, she sold a lot of pieces as well that are these ethereal, zodiac, celestial type pieces, where she would create the characters in DAZ and put tons of love into the poses and the textures and everything. And then I would work in Octane to further bring the textures to life and animate and, you know, and all that. And she would also sit with me throughout the whole process. She also knows Cinema 4D somewhat because she started to get into dailies as well. Beeple like directly encouraged her, and she was like, fine. You know? And she was like way too ambitious with it. And we were like doing the Bumble Mouse series was all from her. Mm.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that was all her. And, you know, yeah, I'm comfortable snapping into that role where I'm more like the pair of hands than the director. But we also, you know, I use my own aesthetic and my own ideas whenever possible. But there are times where, you know, I just completely defer to her because she has better ideas. She's also in general just like the idea girl. Like if I'm like, what should I do here? She's just like, and there's a blank slate. She's like, do this. I'm like, oh, yeah, that's a great idea. You know, awesome. So
I love that.
Obviously that, like, I'm super, super lucky. But yeah, with her Zodiac girls, that was really fun. Like every time there'd be a new challenge, whether it was like little glitter particles or all sorts of things that we were figuring out together. And then there were pieces where we, like recently we created a piece that was a tribute to this NFT artist who had died from cancer tragically named A Lot of Money. He was a really big NFT artist during the bull run, and he did make a lot of money. But and his art was like this really cool, like Monty Python style, and he had like a really, really cool vibe. So there was like a tribute auction to him where all the pieces of art were inspired by his work. And that was through Maker's Place. And for the Trevor Jones Castle Party, which is this cool party in France, we didn't get to go, but looked amazing. But we made a piece that was like this mermaid and had all of these like iconic things from his body of work, like floating past the mermaid where she would like look up at it and appreciate each one. And, there was weed, seaweed, and, you know, a bank underwater and all sorts of like, it was one of these pieces that was locked off, but I just put all the tons of detail in the animation and everything, kind of like how Cornelius Domrich will sit there for a couple months designing a single still, or I think Billy Chitkin's another really good example. People who just like, they create a single composition, lock the camera, and then they put fuckloads of detail into everything in the scene. Kind of what I was doing there. But yeah, Chelsea, you know, was there every step of the way, like helping me make decisions, and she designed the mermaid character and applied the animation. And, you know, so yeah, we have, and we're going to create more of her pieces together in the really near future. So yeah.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Yeah. My wife also is my biggest art critic, you know. Nice. I don't even want to say art critic, because honestly, it's just so helpful, those advice. The amount of times, I don't know why, she's made me realize I have a weird thing when I'm sculpting models. I always make the heads too big. She's nice. Like, why, yeah. Why do you keep, it's like, you got to scale it down by a third. I'm like, oh my God, how did I not see that every time? I'm like, you know.
No, you definitely need to know your weak spots to overcome them. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. I have one more question, but I wanted to see if Andrew, because I think this is going to be the finale question for me. And I told Andrew before we started, I was like, we could probably have a 10-hour long podcast. Yeah, easily. But I want to respect
you. You just got to get out to Colorado, or when you're
that'd be awesome.
We could do a, yeah, we could carry this on forever. I feel like I still feel like I have so many questions.
I know. I'm like, man, we only hit like half the questions.
Straight up at this point, I think they're also just more like personal questions. Sure. So I will hold them for, you know, we're in touch now. So I promise definitely not to like overload your DMs.
But no, you're totally fine. It's actually not bad. My DMs are not very full for whatever reason. Like I answer people at like a steady pace, but it's never become overwhelming, which I'm pretty grateful for. It would be sad not to be able to answer people just because it would become a whole job. Yeah.
I can only imagine. But yeah, so to your point, Mikey, no, I'm good. I'm good on questions. I say let's round it out with the finale here.
All right. So I just wanted to ask this. This was, you know, on your bio reel, there was one part, I was watching it, you know, writing questions for today. I'm sitting with my wife and both at the same time. When we finished your reel, we were like, we've got to ask this part.
Yeah.
I'm hoping I don't butcher it, but just because if we started with the reel, we're going to end kind of how you ended the reel. And I just thought this was so powerful. But you said, I was raised as an atheist, but my art brought me to a place
where I could overcome that lack of belief in anything, where I could understand that we are all creators for the time that we're here, and that using our hearts as a guide will lead to a life full of positive energy and abundance, and anything else is blocking that. What exists out there is incredible, and it's incredible that we're discovering the universe and inventing the universe every day. My goal in life is just to touch the people who visit my experiences and see my art and fill them with positive energy.
So beautiful. I mean, honestly, because as somebody that's open-minded to everything, I'm very much agnostic to any sorts of beliefs out there, and I love to hear and learn experiences, but I just thought that was so cool. I just absolutely loved hearing like we are kind of creators in our own universe, and
and
our own state of being. And I just love that, in a sense, we are kind of our own essence of beauty. And I just wanted to ask, since I thought that was so great and amazing, could you just tell us a little bit more about that story, and what kind of like, at what point did you kind of come to this realization and awakening? And
I still am. This is like the freshest for me to a large degree. You know, I feel like I used to be a lot more closed-minded. You know, I grew up in a place where my family very harshly judged anyone who was religious, and they included spirituality in that camp, like that spiritual people are thinking magically, that you're not facing reality. You're not, you're not you're not based in science. You're thinking mystically, and that's stupid. So there was like a lot of harsh judgment from the, you know, from my upbringing. And only now have I started to, overcome that, I would say. Mm. And part of it is from, you know, seeing the madness of the pandemic and, you know, becoming just more open-minded to any and everything. Part of it is from staring at the stars every night with my wife and just like being like, you know what? We're really, really fucking small. We really don't know that much. Our science isn't that good. So maybe some of these things that people are experiencing or seeing, maybe some of it has validity. Like maybe some of this could apply to me. And why don't I just try it rather than judge it? And if it makes me feel better, which it does, then, oh, that's great. I'll incorporate it into my life and I'll stop, you know, being so up in my head and get more into my heart. And that's been the process of my art as well. Like it's an interesting arc and trajectory that I started with this art that's highly technical, almost like science. And by overcoming that barrier of technicality and getting it to be where it's more like playing music, it's more like actually creating art, I feel more like a creator. I feel more like I'm creating universes, and that is like a God power. And, but I want to use it responsibly. I do want to spread positive energy. And, you know, Chelsea came back recently from a conference that was a traditional art conference. And the leader of that conference gave a speech at one point, and she said something along the lines of, it's the job of artists to bring heaven to earth. Like it's, you know, it's literally like we're crafting beauty. We're searching for beauty. Imagine a society that's led by artists, and maybe how much better and nicer and more peaceful that would be than people that are power hungry. Right.
Wow.
So, yeah, I mean, I think we have a really big responsibility as artists to, you know, if we really believe that we're artists and not technicians, to become more well-rounded people, to do soul searching, to find what we want to say, what we want to give to the world. Like these are much higher level questions, and you can't do that if your tunnel vision is just like the art or the software or just like the technical aspects of it, which is, you know, I've had talks in my Discord. Like we used to have lots of Discord hangouts, and, you know, I would go around the room and ask people like, what are your hobbies? You know, and most people are like, hobbies, I do art for a living. Art, my art is my fun and it's my everything. And it's like that kind of, I used to be there too, but that kind of one track mind, I think, is pretty unhealthy. And I think you need to find other things in the world. You need to go out and travel. You need to experience what the world has to offer to lend more weight and more beauty to your art, if that makes sense.
Mm, absolutely. Yeah. With traveling too, I've like been listening to, it's interesting going into like neurologist, like kind of mindset, listen to a few on some podcasts recently. Mm-hmm. Love neurology, psychology, all of these things. But one thing was just neuroplasticity with just kind of like how you solve problems. And mm-hmm. I kind of have been viewing it as almost like how you also make artwork. And it was just saying that as you're growing, if you keep doing the same thing over and over and don't have any additional inputs, that your solutions are always going to be the exact same thing, and your output is going to turn into the same thing. And the only way to actually expand your output is by having a variety of inputs. And the biggest ways they did say was traveling and learning a new language. And so I completely agree with having like different aspects of getting new inspiration for creativity is how you're going to expand your own artwork.
And like, what is it? I mean, just weighing in, I think it is very beautiful, David, and I totally agree. Like, it's actually, when I hear that, it's kind of something I feel like I need to hear right now too. I mean, it's, you know, in a the flip side of that, I think post COVID, it's just a crazy, crazy, crazy world, and I think everyone has taken different things away from it. And I feel like for me, it was very much like, what is it all in service of, if not to do things other than art? I don't know if that makes sense. Not doing art, but like just making stuff, you know, like I spent 10 years being like, I gotta be technically proficient and I have to know like every tool and I have to do all this stuff and I gotta learn all these things. And I, you know, for me, it was like, it was partly COVID, but I mean, my now wife, at the time we weren't even engaged, but there came a point in our relationship where she's like, you have to do you have to do one other thing. You have to like, yeah. You can't work 18 hours a day every day, exactly. And then be exhausted. And then the time we do spend together, all you're talking about yeah, is what's the stuff that you didn't get. And I'm, you know, you take a step back and suddenly you're like, I'm doing all this work. And I'm just like, for, you know, that is when I think it starts to become a selfish thing and not, yeah. You know, there's always a bit of selfishness in creation, in creating, I think.
Right.
And that's okay. But like the second that it starts being like, you're losing loved ones and you have nothing
exactly.
going
like,
on.
What's, I mean, what's the point of your life here? You need to take a step back. And that's what happened to me during NFTs. Like NFTs were the other part. So first it was COVID, but then also NFTs being like, money's not even real. None of this is real. Like I can make, you know, like this is a completely new idea in society that makes absolutely no goddamn sense, but everybody's agreeing to it. So it's actually working. So that combined with, the bear market hitting was actually the next phase of that. So after this insane like hype phase and all the money and like, we're rich, we're gonna be, this is our life forever, you know, like whatever. Then like this mega crash, but the bear market actually caused me to take a step back and realize that I've been grinding for like 12 years straight, that I hardly ever take vacations. When I do, it's to meetups, you know, when I do, it's centered around work, you know, and in that way I was living my dad's version of his life, you know, and not just like actually experiencing the world or going out into nature or taking up new hobbies. So I was like, okay, we've got all this money. And now I'm seeing above the clouds and I'm not having to like stress grind constantly. What do we do with life now? And it's like, what are my actual priorities here? Oh yeah, it's my wife. It's my stepson. It's my, you know, this little family we have. And also just like appreciating the world that we're living in. So like we spent a whole summer like going out to this one spot in nature like every freaking day, and it was like amazing, and I want to be back in that life because I had to return to the client grind to some degree. That sucks, you know. And like I want art as part of my life, but I only want it to be a part of my life, you know. And I want to feed all of these other habits and things that make me feel like a more mentally healthy, balanced person.
You know, back to the idea of, we've talked a little bit about like the neuroplasticity and just like the brain science of creation and everything. I always mention this because when I heard this, and it was actually from a talk from a really great product dev lead at a company I was at when I was in-house doing some marketing stuff. She gave this talk where she basically talked about, you know, what is the path to getting a eureka moment, or like when you're really working hard on a problem, like what are the conditions to solve it, you know, where you're like, you know, you wake up in the middle of the night and you're like, oh, that's it, like that's the lightning strike, you know, that I needed. And the best way, as far as we know, as far as our brain science can figure out, the best way to solve problems is to stop working on the problem and do something totally different. Right? Mm-hmm. So, and I mean, I used to work 16 hour days, and I look back and I think, you know, probably at least an hour or two of those days were fruitless. Like me clicking a button over and over again, expecting a different result because I was unable to, you know, physically unable to have brain capacity to solve the problem. So it's like when you start making these like small connections and you realize like, yeah, maybe for me, I love to cook, or I love to, I love plants. I love like planting things,
exactly,
growing plants and stuff. I don't know. Like everyone's got their own thing, but you know, it is important and it does serve it. You might not feel like it. It might not feel like, well, I'm not posting something, or I'm not doing client work, or I'm not getting new clients, or I'm not whatever.
That's like, you that have to know brain, that it's still,
yeah.
That kind of brain is almost an addiction. I've been there so many times. And it's like, if you find yourself, you know, in life constantly thinking about work, I think you're doing it wrong.
Yeah.
If you're like, I'm on vacation, but man, I should be doing this, and I should, like, the should be's are just that, like, I don't know if you're your parents or this like judgmental voice in your head or what. But you know, maybe you should follow what you enjoy, what you want to be doing, rather than what you should be doing.
Yeah.
And like, we have a lot of ideas about what we should be doing, but a lot of the time that's not actually the healthiest, you know?
Yeah, no, it is. I mean, again, like going out and enjoying those experiences. I went through a little rut a few months ago, and I kind of just had to tell myself, I think I was talking when we had Death Render on, but I was saying essentially that when you go to actually enjoy yourself, like out on vacation, when you stop thinking about work and then come back to work, you're going to feel 100 times better and more refreshed. Like being able to compartmentalize work and time with family, friends, going out on new experiences is actually going to make you a better artist. Like it's hard to think about that, but you know, again, if you're only thinking about where, if you're only staying on a one track mind, then every solution and every problem you come to, you're going to be doing the same thing over and over and over again. You know, sometimes you just need to walk around a different path in order to figure out the solution. Absolutely. And, you know, I just want to also say one last thing that I really did like, but
I was going to respond to you and say that, like, for me nowadays, though, when I come back from vacation, I'm just like, but I want more vacation, you know? but a lot of now, though, the cool thing is that, like, while it feels like pulling teeth for client work and I get back and I'm like, fuck, I have to do this client work again, my art is something that I just internally want to keep creating. Like, I'm like constantly rendering VR stuff in the background because it's so fun and exciting for me, you know? So if you can find your passion as an artist where it feels like play to the degree where you never resent it. Like that's, I think that's, you know, I'm trying to recapture like the beginning of my career. Like when you first get started, you're on this hype, like excitement, you're watching all the tutorials and it's so fun. And at some point you plateau and you get a little bit tired of it and it becomes like where you start to resent it a little bit, you know, even though, yeah, like you're blessed and it's fun and it's like art and it's not that you're not working at Burger King, you're not doing these like shitty jobs, monotonous, whatever, like your mind is constantly engaged, you're constantly solving new problems. You can still, you know, start to be like, am I just going to create work for clients for the rest of my life? You know, and question like, what is your bigger purpose, you know?
Yeah. And that's, that was kind of a perfect segue to what I was going to say. But, you know, speaking of kind of like almost like this atheist or scientific mindset, you know, where it's kind of like becoming so logical with everything, which I'm also a huge supporter of. And my mindset is there probably half of my life,
right?
When thinking about things. But it's very much like a search for a logical explanation when it comes through that atheist mindset, which is great. But it is so true through an emotional exploration through art. And like you're saying, like you have people in business suits with their hands in the air, like scream, like having this whole new emotional aspect. And that in itself is like a spiritual awakening in them and being able 100%. To give that new feeling to somebody for the first time is, you're a creator. And it's like a whole different world, I mean, you know?
People would put on the headset and they would come out and be like, I wouldn't tell them anything. And they would be like, I didn't know that technology could be spiritual.
Yeah.
Like, I didn't know I could have a spiritual experience through technology. So that's where I know that I'm onto something, you know, and it's, and it is a bit indescribable. Like I still can't even fully explain what spirituality means to me or for me, other than being open-minded and trying more things, like accepting other people's beliefs and, you know, like just experimenting with life and how we design our lives and how, you know, and getting out of that, like the logical brain is great, but I've had so much of that my whole life, you know, and now I want to be more in this emotional state or this state of feeling and expanding my mind to the possibilities of what is right in front, beyond what's just right in front of us, you know, like looking at the stars, like thinking, okay, there probably are alien civilizations out there that know a lot more shit than us or that feel a lot more shit. And, you know, or just like even just knowing that we're so small and what our knowledge is so small. Like, why do we write so much off? Why do we plant our feet so firmly in the sand and say, I know for sure there's no God. I know for sure there's no prime creator or whatever you want to call it. I know for sure that there's no magic in the world, you know?
Right.
I know for sure that when you die, you're snuffed out and you never live again and that's it. And, you know, and so in a way that creates a bit of a nihilistic kind of wound inside of you, I believe. Mm. If you really, truly believe that, which I did, I would have these existential crises. I would have panic attacks about death, you know?
Oh yeah, man. 100%. I totally sympathize with that. I mean, that was, I was actually raised Roman Catholic and then I kind of like went rebelled and was
right. Like, and that's the other
not that at all. And then suddenly I was like, Wait, these are just way too limiting. Like it was it was a too rigid way to think about the world. And truthfully, you know, if you make the whatever, I'm not going to get too into it. But yeah, I mean, it's like you can't if we can't really prove anything, then like why would you be so like why the rigidity doesn't check out at for me at that point where it's like, well, there's no point in really like tying myself to either anchor. Like maybe I just try to be what I was when I was like 4 years old. Just
recapturing,
living my own little trip, you know, imagining bushes were spaceships and I don't know, whatever. Like,
I think it's in a way, it's a more healthy and better way to live. Like trying, like recapturing that childlike innocence and seeing beauty in everything and appreciating everything in your life more, it will make you a happier person. Mm. So I totally am all for that.
Well, I feel like we're coming up on time here, so I do want to just kind of close it off. But I mean, David, for anyone who wants to keep current with all your projects and see more of your work and just engage with the experiences you're creating, where can they find you?
Just at David Aryev on Twitter, Instagram, I guess Facebook as well. My site is aryevvisuals.com. That's with two V's in a row, which, yeah, my name is weird. It's spelled with a W. It's pronounced as a V. Doesn't make any sense. Aryevvisuals.com. But I'm most active on Twitter nowadays because that's where the NFT scene exists. And that's where I like to sell my digital art.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for all your time, man. I think it's such an enlightening viewpoint. And I feel like anyone who heard all this is probably just going to be like, I gotta go meditate and make some awesome art tomorrow.
Oh yeah. That's exactly what I love people to pull from this. And thank you guys for the awesome, engaging conversation and the really insightful, deep questions. I super appreciate it. I'm probably going to steal the rant I had about Octane and post that as its own thing and be like, this is why Octane's awesome.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yep.